Maybe, thank you everyone for taking your time and effort to come to this workshop. This is a joint workshop with Kyoto University. This is the first time this workshop takes place in Taiwan. Thank you. There's a small adjustment in the program. One of the speaker, Tristan, has some problems with his flight. So we have to swap the program. So the talk this afternoon, his talk this afternoon will be replaced by Carl Bartosan, and then he will give his talk tomorrow. Okay. About the talk, it will be 15 minutes for the main speaker. So including questions. So 45 minutes for the talk, and then five minutes for the question. Okay. I think that should be enough. So let me first send to Professor Kawai. He will tell us about quantum gravity and naturalness.
Thank you very much. So this is a joint workshop with MCTS and Kyoto University. So I don't know exactly to whom I should acknowledge, but at risk to Professor Chu. So it's a great honor to be here. So this is the plan of my talk. So first I let's talk about the Higgs and Planck scale. So this is from the topological side. And then I would like to discuss fine-tuning by nature itself. And then finally, I would like to discuss the emergence of standard model scale from Planck scale. And if I have time, I would like to mention this. So I would like to start from the notion of desert. And we know standard model is good to high energy scales. So experimentally, LHC told us that standard model is good, at least below a few TeV. And actually, no signal for new particles or new physics are discovered, and especially no indication of low energy supersymmetry. And theoretically, we can investigate the UV region of the standard model by denormalization group test. And then we see no contradiction below Planck scale or string scale. But here I would like to use the name Planck scale or string scale, and I do not distinguish these two. And all the couplings are small, and the perturbative picture is very good up to Planck scale. For example, so the horizontal axis, this is essentially the running couplings, but here, we regard horizontal axis as a cutoff scale. And vertical axis represents bare parameter. So this is SU3, SU2, and U1. So U1 is a bit growing. So Planck scale is around here. But even top of Yukawa coupling for top core and Higgs coupling, everything is very small. So around this region, perturbation is really good. So it is natural to imagine that the standard model is directly connected to the string scale dynamics, such as quantum gravity, without large modification. This is what they say, the desert. And also, the denormalization group analysis indicates that there are some mysterious coincidence. So that is, the three quantities, bare Higgs mass, Higgs coupling, and beta function for Higgs coupling, and bare Higgs mass, three of them become zero around the string scale. I will show a picture in the next slide. But at any rate, the Higgs potential becomes flat or zero around the string scale. So actually, this was predicted by Robert and Nielsen a long time ago. And the argument is based on some special principle called multiple point criticality principle, which I abbreviate MPP. So this is a picture. So So this is a Kato scale, and so Planck scale is around here. And this is a Higgs cell coupling. And the origin of error is error of top of mass. So we have some band, but lambda is going to zero around max. And also this is a beta function for lambda. And again, this becomes zero around Planck scale. And this is a picture for beta mass. And this time, the point where beta mass becomes zero is a bit bigger than Planck scale. But at any rate, this is decreasing. And also, this is a picture for the Higgs potential. So Higgs potential is just a running coupling for phi. So horizontal axis and vertical axis are value of phi and value of potential. And here, both axes are linear, so not logarithmic scale. So this is 10 to 17, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, multiplied by 10 to 17 g. And also vertical axis is, this is about 10 to 64. This is just a gut scale to the force. And so the point is, if we tune the top of mass or top view power, I think we shouldn't take these numbers so seriously because we have a lot of sources for errors. But the point is, the fine tuning, it's a sort of fine tuning. But if we tune top of mass like this, then the potential looks like this. And if we increase the top of mass a bit, then potential looks like that. Or if we decrease the top of mass a bit, so we have this kind of potential. And this green curve stands for the situation predicted by Rogat and Nixon. So here I would like to discuss the possibility of Higgs equation for this choice of scaling. So if the MT is chosen in such a way that the potential becomes flat, then it suggests the possibility of Higgs equation. And there are two typical attempts in this direction. The first attempt is so-called critical Higgs equation. So in this case, we trust this is a kind of toy model. And in this case, we trust the flat potential, including the inflection point. So actually, so this is around string scale. So we do not know whether we can trust this calculation. This calculation is just based on standard model. So we do not know whether we can trust around this region. But here, we assume the flat potential. We can trust the flat potential, even for that. So this means we assume the nature does fine tuning on the standard model parameters if necessary. So here we assume that the parameter is chosen in such a way that the potential becomes flat. Then we introduce a non-minimal coupling of order 10. I will show this in the next slide. So this is the first trial. And next one is more conservative. So we trust the effective potential only below the string scale. So we trust our calculation only this region. And try to make a bound on the physical parameter. So this is a case for the Higgs, the critical Higgs simulation. So we assume that the top view power is chosen in such a way that potential looks like this. And we introduce a non-minimal coupling, z, r, and phi square. Phi is an expectation value for Higgs. So r, Higgs square, and some coupling. Dimensionless. And in this,
excuse me.
Yes?
In this argument, Suji doesn't represent anything.
Okay, so I assume Suji doesn't exist. Yeah. So, okay, so.
But then your standpoint, the Suji will just emerge to. Same point
Okay, yes, yes, that's true, yes. So our standard viewpoint is supersymmetry is broken at the stream scale. Okay, so this is the simplest choice. Okay, so okay, at least okay, around this scale, stream scale, stream dynamics switches on. So we cannot trust this region. Okay, but so this is a sort of toy model. So we just assume that we can trust the potential even around here. So this is just a model. Is that okay?
You say that perturbation will just go up to the grand indication scale.
Mm-hmm.
And this minimization group analysis is innovative perturbation.
Yeah, right.
So I still don't understand that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so the point is, as we have seen here, okay, so this is just a calculation based on standard model. So all the couplings become small around the string scale. So once you assume standard model is good up to string scale, we can trust the calculation, at least around here. But at the string scale, string dynamics will switch on. So we cannot trust this part.
Well, that's the assumption.
Yeah, exactly.
The problem that you introduced, mm-hmm. you also include that in the RG analysis.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes. Okay, so. In this analysis.
Yeah, in this analysis.
Okay, that's a good point. And actually, okay, so if we change the top of, okay, so you cover for top, and then if we change this a bit, then the shape for Higgs cell coupling changes drastically. So here we have chosen that top you cover is around this value. Otherwise, this is a huge circle. So if we choose Yukawa top a bit larger, then big Yukawa coupling becomes negative contribution to the beta function. So this curve looks like this. And if we
non-minimal
coupling. Mm-hmm. Okay, sorry. So you are talking about this non-minimal.
Yeah,
this
is included in the
RG analysis. Oh, no. So this just we include this for changing Jordan frame to Einstein frame.
Yeah.
So okay. So in principle, so this also switches on around here.
Yeah.
So but in this analysis, we simply assumed this potential from standard model minimization group, and we just add this to the effective graph.
So in principle, but this one can also include this and then consider standard model in some background.
Yes, I think so.
Yeah, in principle, copy yes.
Yes. Yeah, I think so. Yeah, but at any rate, as Townsend asked, we cannot trust all the calculation here, literally. Mm-hmm. So I think we should regard this as sort of point. So, okay, so we introduce this non-minimal coupling. And in the original Higgs impression by Bezukhov and Shaposhnikov, they had to introduce Xi around 10,000. But because Higgs potential is flat from the beginning, as we have seen, so in this time, Xi around 10 is enough. So actually, if we introduce Xi around 10, so the potential is stretching in the horizontal direction when we go to the Einstein frame. And we can make a realistic equation model. So this is the first trial. And the second trial is the Chernyak one. So in this case, we simply assume that the non-minimal couplings are not so large. So here we assume this is less than 100. Then we can trust our field theory up to square root MP over square root Z, this is essentially string scale. So we then have a lower bound on the vacuum energy at the equation. So this is the picture. So this is lambda. Lambda is around the string scale. So we can trust the calculation here. But we don't know what is going on here. But at least if we assume slow rolling, slow roll, so we have some potential here, which we cannot calculate from the standard method. But at any rate, we can say the value of the potential at inflation is larger than the maximum value of the potential, which can be calculated from computation, from PLC. Because this should roll down to this, so the potential, this potential should be larger than this. So we have this inequality. Also, we don't know what is going on here. At least we can set this inequality home. And in a slow roll, R is the so-called tensor to scalar ratio. So and AS is a scalar perturbation. So R multiplied by AS is tensor perturbation. So this is tensor perturbation is known to proportional to the potential here. And the coefficient is calculated like this in Planck's parameter. And we know scalar perturbation is about this number by experiment. So this means R is proportional to the potential at inflation. So R is proportional to potential at inflation, being inflation. But we know this one is greater than this. So we have a lower bound for R. So R is greater than this quantity multiplied by some. So we get this kind of inequality. And using this inequality, we can examine small modifications of standard model. So for example, we can consider a standard model plus Higgs-Potter scalar dark matter. And the Higgs-Potter scalar dark matter is just a scalar, singlet scalar. And it couples to Higgs field like this, x squared and x. And kappa is a kappa. And since we know the total amount of dark matter, so if dark matter is heavy, then the number of dark matter should be small. And the number should be small means it should decouple later in the early universe. So the coupling should be larger. So we know this result. So dark matter mass is proportional to the coupling, and the coefficient is given like this. And this comes from the amount of that matter observed. So at any rate, we know this. So the horizontal axis is dark matter mass, but essentially this means a coupling between dark matter and here. So the point is, if coupling is large, then the potential for the beta function for Higgs is pushed up, then the potential is pushed up. So this means, okay, so for example, if top of mass is around here, for example, 176 or so, so we have this curve. And this vertical line is from potential positivity. So if coupling is too small, then the lambda becomes negative at some point. So the potential becomes unstable. So this side is excluded. And as we have seen from this inequality, if kappa is if kappa is large, then potential is large, so R becomes large from this. So this is this coupling. So once the top of mass is fixed, we can say this coupling is in this region. This coupling and R. The vertical axis is R. And the experimental bound is about 0.1 here. So we are very close to the bound here. So in this way, this is just one example. and we can add that magnitude or so. But at any rate, using this inequality, we can examine what kind of small modifications are allowed. So, to summarize for this point, so standard model is valid to the string scale, at least theoretically. And standard model might be directly connected to the string scale without large modification. And Hughes-Field is near the stability bound, and the bare Higgs mass is close to zero at the string scale. And it implies that Higgs is a massless state of string cell. And also Higgs cell coupling and its beta function become zero at the string scale. So Higgs potential might be flat around the string scale, and it suggests the possibility of Higgs inflation. So this is a situation of the standard model around the string scale. So I'd like to discuss the fine-tuning by nature itself. There are several attempts to extend the conventional framework of the local velocity in order to solve the fine-tuning problem. One is asymptotic safety, and we also have multiple point principle by Robert Nielsen, and cross-cal conformality for baby universe and multi-local action. So they are more or less related. And I would like to concentrate on these two possibilities. MPP and classical mind. So, I would like to start with MPP of Robertson Nielsen. Every time I talk about this, I make some comment on Nielsen, but I think many of you have heard of it already. So, anyway, the point is I try to understand this, and I several times I talked to Professor Nielsen, but he's an excellent physicist, but somehow I couldn't get a precise idea from him. So in this sense, so this is my interpretation of their work. And I hope this interpretation is not very far from their original idea. So imagine a system that is described by the passenger of not the canonical ensemble like this, but the microcanonical ensemble like this. Or an even more general ensemble like this. And here, the weight F is a function of S1, S2, and so on. And Si's are local action. I will explain this point later a bit more explicitly. But the point is, the weight is a function of local action. So this is a delta function of local action. This is the exponential of some local action. So this is, instead of considering this, we generalize the problem to this kind of problem. So the statement is, still the system is equivalent to the ordinary field theory in the large space-time volume. Now I would like to explain this point later. But the parameters of the corresponding field theory are automatically fixed, such that the vacuum is at a multiple criticality point. So this is their statement. So I would like to explain. In fact, we can show that the low energy effective theory of quantum gravity or string theory is given by this kind of which I call multi-local action. So this is the effective action. And so S1, S2, and those things are local action. So here, for example, if we take one, this is nothing but the volume of the universe. So this is a small constant one. And if we take R, this is nothing but Einstein-Hilbert action. And if we take X squared, this is Hamilton action, and so on. And the point is, effective action is a function of this local action. So if we expand F with respect to S, so we have a linear term. And this part is nothing special. This is just superposition of local action. So this one itself is overarching.
How do you differentiate one action to the other?
What do you mean differentiate?
It's one and it's mm-hmm. two bodies different.
Okay, so in principle you consider all possibilities. Okay, so S1, S2, S3, and S4. So we consider all possible local action.
Is but what is the difference between S1 and S2? Okay. Component is different or?
Okay, S1 is just square root G. Okay, for example, if we take this. Okay, and S2 is just Einstein-Hilbert action, if we take this. And S3 is just R square Lagrange, and so on and so on. So I don't think I have time to explain this point, but the original idea comes from Coleman around 1990. So he discussed if you include the effect of wormhole, your effect of action. Okay, so their argument is stronger than this. So whatever action you have, okay, this one is okay and this one is okay, but maybe this is the most general form is this. Okay, so the function of local action. So because S effective is a function of size, we can express the exponential I is effective by a Fourier transform. Like here, lambdas are Fourier conjugate variable to Si, so we have lambda I is I, and W is a function of lambda I. So the point is here, lambda is just a number. So S is a local action, but the effective action is a function of local action. So regarding S as independent variables, so we introduce this. So lambdas are just numbers. Lambdas are not field and not action, so they are just numbers. So then the path integral for S effective becomes like this. So S effective is given by this. So after interchanging the order of integral for lambda and phi, we have this expression. And this part is something like this, and because all i's are local operators, this part, summation lambda I s I, is an ordinary local action. This is just a superposition of local action. And here, lambda I's are regarded as the coupling constant. So therefore, the system is the ordinary field theory, but we have to integrate over the coupling constant with some weight W. And W is Fully transform of this one. So this is a path integral, and we have this one. But this part is nothing but the partial function of the ordinary field theory given by this action. So here lambda i's are just coupling constants. So this is a function of a coupling constant. So we, z lambda. And then this total integral becomes like this. So we have z lambda multiplied by lambda and integral. So if a small region around lambda 0 dominates the integral, it means that the coupling constants are fixed to lambda 0. So the question is if this is true or not. So this is one story, and there are various possibilities, but here I introduce this kind of story. Okay. So since our universe has been cooled down for a long time, we can approximate the partition function by the vacuum energy density multiplied by space-time volume, and we have minus half. So I think it is quite natural to assume. And then if this vacuum energy per unit volume is smooth and has an extremum like this, then we have a very large number here, and we have some function with extreme. So we know extremum, the value around extremum dominate, and we show this is almost a delta function, and the error is one of p. So in this case, so lambda is fixed to lambda c in the large volume. So this is quite simple, and we just have assumed this form. And if we assume that the universe is cooled down for a long time, then if we have a minimum, the lambda are locked to the minimum value. And a bit more general case is kink. Here we assume that the vacuum energy for unit volume behaves like this. Here, at lambda equal lambda c, we have some kink. But in each side, the function is monotone. So if we assume this, we can show again, if b is very large, again the value around the kink dominates. And this time error is, this one is 1 over b, and this is 1 over b squared. So again, the error is proportional to 1. And this can be easily shown, or this is just a matter of simple calculation. And, for example, if we start from this expression, we have exponential I p x and phi x, we integrate over x, and if b is large, by repeating partial integration, so we have this one integrate multiplied by this, and the error is 1 over b squared. So if the function is monotonic, we can replace x with fx with this measure 1 over y. So again, we have this expression. So in each side, we can use it. So at kink, we have a difference between the contribution from this part and the contribution from this part. So we have this expression. So again, the point at kink dominant. And if we consider the time evolution of the universe, the definition of z lambda is not a priori clear because the universe develops with time. For example, we need to specify the initial and final state to give a good definition for z lambda. But even if we do not know the precise form of z lambda, we expect that a similar mechanism to the previous case. What? For example, some of the couplings can be determined without knowing the detail of the lambda. So one is based on symmetry, and a good example is theta QCD. And actually, this was done by Nielsen and Minomi a long time ago, at the time of Coleman's big universe. So the argument is essentially the same. So the point is, this theta QCD becomes important only after the QCD. And the mass spectrum of hadron is invariant under the creeping sign of that theta QCD. So it is expected that B is even in theta QCD. So we don't know whether theta QCD looks like this or looks like this, but if it behaves like this, theta QCD is zero. So the argument is strong CP problem. Automatically solved by nature itself. And the second possibility is edge of drastic change. So we assume these two conditions. So physics changes drastically at some value of coupling. So if we change the coupling, physics on this side and physics on this side are totally different. So, and also these monotonic or elsewhere. Then the couplings are tuned to the value of lambda c. Essentially, the argument is the same as the case of this kink. So once we don't know what z is exactly, but if at lambda c, if physics changes drastically, so lambda is locked to this one. So there are several examples. So one is a Higgs-Seeley coupling. So as we have seen, if we change the Higgs coupling or the top power, the physics change drastically. Here, so if we tune, if we change the parameter a bit, so we have this potential or this. So in the early universe, the situation is totally different. So this is one explanation why Tokyo Kawa is fixed to this situation. And another example is a cosmological constant. And if cosmological constant is positive, we have closed universe. And if it's negative, we have open. So physics changes drastically. So cosmological constant should be fixed to zero. Well, classical conformality is also explained by this kind of argument. And I will come back to this later. But still there are many open questions. So we have to explain Higgs mass. We have to explain why Higgs mass is around 100 GeV. And also, we should distinguish degenerate vacuum or flat potential. So, as we have seen, this is one possibility. So this is the original program of Nielsen. So this is first order phase transition. And, but this is also a critical point in some sense. At this critical value, we have a Higgs simulation. But we do not know which one we should choose. Both are critical points, but we need some principle to distinguish which one is a true value. So this is all that. And also, the cosmological constant is actually non-zero. If we literally believe this argument, cosmological constant is exactly zero, but we know cosmological constant is non-zero. So again, we have to explain. And also, there was a big problem, and still it is not solved. We have too much big things. So if we repeat this kind of argument, so probably the free field theory is chosen. Free field theory is also a highly multiple point calculus. So why not free field? So this is too much. So at any rate, to answer these questions, we need a precise form of the lambda. So maybe we have to develop a theory of the function of mass class.
Would this
self-tuning mechanism
works
for the later
stage of the cosmic evolution?
Yes.
So, for example, in the beginning of the inflation, we can say that
the
cosmological constant should be still
integrated. Yeah, right. Yeah. But the point is, okay, so we know, okay, we believe our stage is for later stage of the universe. And we know that the cosmological constant is non-zero, a few millielectron volts to the whole. So in this sense, so as we have seen here, that's a very good point. So essentially, we are assuming something like this. We have large space-time volume and something. So this one, so late stage of universe dominates in this kind of expression. So what we believe, if we believe we are already in late stage, so from this argument, if we accept this argument literally, then the cosmological constant should be zero. But we know the cosmological constant is a few millielectron volts.
So if we come back to the time, then at some stage, the universe
with
a different coupling constant
enters
into
this
dimension.
Yeah. So in this sense, we know the precise form of the lambda. It's a good point, and I don't know the answer, so maybe we should solve this problem. So here I would like to concentrate on Higgs mass problem. So I would like to explain the emergence of the standard model scale from quantum scale. And this one is based on work with Haruna, and Haruna-san is going to talk the detail of this work. So I just sketch just 5 minutes. So basic assumption is standard model is directly connected to the string theory without large modification. So maybe we have a small modification like use for the dark matter or light hand neutrino, but anyway, without large modification, this is not. And the fundamental scale of string theory is of course only the Planck scale or string scale. So the question is, how does the weak scale appear? So everybody's guess is a weak scale must appear as a non-perturbative. Then it is related to the Planck scale like this. So Higgs mass is Planck scale multiplied by some non-perturbative effect, exponential minus constant over nothing constant. And the large hierarchy is naturally understood. If we have some number and GS is small, about 0.1 or so, so we can explain the large hierarchy. So the question is find a phenomenologically acceptable mechanism like this. So there are various possibilities. So one is a QCD like dimensional transmutation. So in QCD we have a QCD scale comes from Hatter lambda and some thing. But this is not compatible with our world because we know our Higgs are weakly coupled. So Higgs are not strong enough. So this cannot be used for us. And second one is the so-called Coleman-Weinberg mechanism. And the original idea is to explain SSB of standard model from the master series. But this one is not acceptable. And so in this case, Higgs mass becomes much less than Higgs depth. But in the real world, this is 125, this is 250. So this is not satisfying. So original idea is not good. And this one is additional gauge plus complex scale. So we make a mass scale independently to the standard model, set up, then transfer it to standard model through that. And this is, and based on this idea, we can make a acceptable model. But I would like to point out here there is an even simpler model. So instead of Coleman-Weinberg case, they introduced one complex scalar and a gauge. And here we introduce just two scales. And I think our notation is not very good. So this is phi and phi, but following tech, I call phi and bar phi. So we have introduce two scalars, phi and phi phi. And also, for simplicity, we assume D2 plus D2 invariants. And then the potential looks like phi 4, bar phi 4, and phi square, bar phi square. And one important assumption is a classical conformality. So we assume we normalize mass at zero. So I would like to point out why we have a classical conformality. And actually, classical conformality is, there are several ways to define classical conformality, but here we assume classical conformality by this statement, normalized mass at zero. And this sounds nonsense for normal field theories, so if you know field theory very much, you know there is no quantum mechanical symmetry that guarantees masslessness of scale, except supersymmetry. And since we discovered the supersymmetry, this is impossible. This is a normal.
Why do you need first of all?
Mm-hmm. This one?
Yeah.
Okay. So we want to describe, okay, so the aim is to explain Higgs mass from Planck scale. So we need some input. The picture is, okay, so we have string theory behind. And from non-perturbative effect, we have a Higgs mass, right? So, but if we assume Higgs mass from the beginning, it's not good. So the point is we assume Higgs mass, the normal Higgs mass is zero, but because of some non-perturbative effect, we have this kind of Higgs mass. This is what I want to say. And this is essentially the same as original Coleman Whitehead. So they assumed the Higgs mass is zero at the beginning, and then obtain mass from SSB. But this is original Coleman Whitehead. So I just want to do the same thing here. And as we have seen, so this is one. So on the other hand, once we accept the existence of self-tuning mechanism, classical conformality is one of the natural choices. So for example, we can take MPP. So MPP is the statement that coupling constants are fixed to critical points. And there are many kinds of critical points. Critical values that the time evolution of the universe changes drastically when they are changed. So this is the meaning of critical value in a wider sense. So we assume that the universe starts from phi equals zero, and then if m squared is positive, phi is metastable. So universe remains in that state for a while. And on the other hand, if the universe mass square is negative, the Bakken expression value for phi, this point is unstable. So universe transitions quickly to another state. So the time of evolution of the universe changes drastically at that point in spectral zero. So at least from this argument, we understand m squared of zero is a sort of critical value. So this is nothing but a classical conformality. And also there are another critical value. Critical value that the phase of the vacuum changes when they are changed. So this is the original Frobenius case. So we assume the first order phase transition, and what we will see is that this actually happens when numerous masses, some critical mass, but maybe there are other types of critical point. But in any case, numerous masses are fixed to some values, and for a while we concentrate on the case one. And so we consider two-scale model, and we impose a classical conformality. Then the result is, this is a very simple system, and the result is for a large region of parameter space, we have three parameters. One of the field has non-zero vacuum threshold. So in the large region of parameter space, one of the Z2 symmetry is spontaneously broken. So this is contrary to the expectation from the tree potential. If we consider just this tree potential, then if rho kappa and kappa prime are or positive, then we do not have SSB. But if we consider root correction, we receive this. I think the argument is quite straightforward, and I will show just the idea, and I think Haruna-san will talk about the detail. So the idea is very simple. So this is a beta function. This is a beta function for rho prime and kappa. And rho is self-coupling for phi, and rho prime is self-coupling for bar phi, and kappa are mutual coupling. So this is a beta function. And we assume the cutoff scale is Planck scale. And there the bare parameters are all positive. This is our assumption. And then when we decrease the renormalization point, one of the coupling becomes zero. So this is bare parameters. These are bare parameters at coupling. And then if we decrease mass scale, one of them becomes zero fast. So we assume rho becomes zero fast. The rho is this one. So rho becomes zero at mu equal to star. So this is possible if we satisfy this condition, we can easily check it. And then it is expected, because rho becomes negative, phi has some vacuum expectation value. And then through this coupling, because kappa is positive, through this coupling, bar phi becomes massive. So the vacuum expectation value of phi is here. So this is sort of something like seesaw, and it depends on which one becomes zero first. So if rho becomes zero first, then phi becomes non-zero. And the other one is invariant. So this is a mix. And we can evaluate the, okay, so, and, so anyway, so in this way we can calculate the vacuum expectation value, and phi develops vacuum expectation value, and bar phi becomes massive. And we can also couple to the standard model. So this is our phi bar phi system, and this is the coupling to the standard model, H is Higgs. So once phi has vacuum expectation value, this gives mass to the Higgs. So in this model, weak scale is generated indirectly by non-perturbability from the Planck scale. So we have a Planck scale, and because of this mechanism, so phi develops vacuum expectation value, and this gives a vacuum expectation value to H. So in this sense, in two steps, so we can give non-perturbative mass to heat. And also, we can see, so we have introduced two scalars, so in addition to standard model, and phi has a vacuum expectation value, so this is the origin of the mass scale for the wave. And the other one, bar phi, is a massive particle, and we can identify it with a Higgs boson model. So in this sense, so this model fits to the idea of Higgs boson model. So this is the point of the work, and actually we can make some realistic models. And for example, if we assume this case, so Higgs boson matter is 1 keV, so this is consistent as we have seen in the beginning of this talk, and then we see bar phi, not bar phi, phi is 25 GeV. So, but this is a gauge singlet, so it doesn't contradict with the experiment. So, but maybe in near future we can see this one. This is not 25. So, maybe we can test for this one. So we can generalize. We can consider various cases for, in addition to classical probability, so in wide classes of quantum gravity or string theory, the low energy effective action has a multi-local form. The fine-tuning problem might be solved by the dynamics of such action. And we need a good definition of the path integral for such action. But as an ad hoc attempt, we can use the generalized MPP and make non-trivial predictions. So, thank you.
Just a very short question. You said that this is generally non-perturbative.
Yeah.
I thought you just talked
to me about it. Okay, yes, thank you. Actually. Yeah. It's a good point.
Yeah.
Yeah. Essentially, the mass scale mu tau b is given by the zero of rho. So, and we can evaluate rho like this. So we can, okay, so if all couplings are small, we can simply we can evaluate the evolution of coupling constant, and from this we see mu star is something rho zero over kappa squared.
So the calculation is the
solution
is one of the coupling. because of the topic last time.
You have supersymmetry behind, mm-hmm. a superstring behind as a invite picture.
Yes.
But Suji doesn't appear anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And you are thinking that the supersymmetry will not appear in the realistic scale?
Right. Okay, so it depends what kind of model you have, but I think at least from experiment we know supersymmetry, the low energy Suji doesn't exist. Right? So we know Suji doesn't exist below 2 TeV now. Right? So and, if we see a string model compactification, okay, and for example, if we construct a so-called Taylor-Lemnick construction under four-dimensional space-time, the number of models without supersymmetry is much larger than number of models with supersymmetry.
Much what?
Much larger.
Much.
Okay, so for in 10 dimension, if we consider heterotic string, okay, SO16 plus SO16 is non-supersymmetric. And E8 plus E8 and SO32 are supersymmetric. So the ratio is 1 to 2 right, in 10 dimensions. But if you go to 4 dimensions, the number of non-Suji is much bigger than number of models.
So the behind the picture, supersymmetry, superstring is there, but Suji will not appear.
I think so. Yeah. Suji will appear only at the Planck scale.
Okay. So maybe we can further discussion over the next speaker. The next speaker is Harold Steinecker.